Okay, I'm going to talk about ancient Assyria. Now, a lot of people think that Egypt were the best engineers of their day, but they weren't the best engineers of their day.
Because the Assyrians would eclipse the Egyptians. As a matter of fact,
what started engineering
more than likely
started with what started as civilization, which began around the Fertile Crescent,
Mesopotamia.
What would the first engineering consist of? Well,
what do you need to have a civilization? You need water.
So you would learn
to manage water.
That would be your first objective. Of course,
these first cities
would be
as close to
a river as possible because you have to be able to get to the water to drink it,
to survive.
So
the water would be
close, as close as possible.
You don't want to have to walk a mile to get water
to drink it. Otherwise, you'd
be spending your
entire day walking. So you also have to
drink
more water because of the region that you're in. And the
possibility
of unbearable heat.
You drink
more water.
And laboring,
of course,
as you would
be doing
when you're
building
a city.
You
also need
to bathe. And I'm pretty sure that
nobody wanted
to run around
covered in dirt
all day. So you
go in the water.
You drink
the water.
You need water.
This
is where engineering begins,
because
what occurs as you're dealing
with
water
is you
figure out
ways of
getting it
closer
to the city.
And making
it more convenient.
So
you start bringing
it
in.
This is
where you start
building
irrigation
canals.
A lot of
time
you look
at
a city's
ruins.
You probably
don't
really
think
about
irrigation
canals. Well, if you don't have
any form of
irrigation
canals,
you gotta
walk
to the water
source.
You might
have wells,
you might have
cisterns,
an aqueduct.
The
first
cities
would
try and
bring
the water
as close
to
the
people
as possible.
And
in order to
do
this,
you
have to
be
able
to
move
the water,
and
you have
to have
a
form
of
plan
to
do
it,
because
you can't
just
start
digging
around
the
river.
And
then
you
would
have to
first
dig
the
ditch
at
a certain
point,
and you would
have
to
spread
that
area
to
where
the water
is going to
go,
and
the
water
runoff
has
to be dealt
with
as well.
So
you would imagine
it would
be a
good idea
to have
it
in
a square
formation
or
something
going
back and
around
your
city,
or
going
through
in
like
a
grid
formation.
Just
get the
water
in
here.
You gotta
have it
running
through
a certain area and then
leaving
back
to the river
again.
A
gradient
is necessary
to
have
the
water moving
in a certain
direction.
So you want to
have
the water
slightly
sloping
downward
to
where
you
want it
to go.
They
would have
thought of this,
of course.
Gravity
takes
care
of the rest,
but they
don't
need
to
have
an understanding
of physics.
You
see
the
water
moving
down
something,
and
you're
pretty
much
aware
of
gravity
itself
because
everything
is
stuck
to
the ground,
so
you
watch
as
things
go
downward.
Like
you try
to climb
a hill,
you
get
pushed
down
it
if it's
too
steep.
But
you want
the
gradient
to
be
at
a
slight
angle.
You don't
want
it to just
be
a
long
sloping
fall.
You want
it
to be, and
this
is kind
of
like
what
you
have with
an
aqueduct.
But
you
have it
on
the ground
now.
So
it's an
irrigation
canal.
You're trying
to
control
where
the
water
moves.
To
bring
it
around
inside
the
city.
You
can
even
have it
move
into
pools
if you
do
it right.
And then
out
of
the pools.
This
is
when
you
start to
learn
how
to manage
sewage.
Because
you think,
hey,
you got
water
coming
in.
You got
the water
leaving.
That's
where
all the
dirty
water
is going.
Of course,
civilization
downstream
from
the river
is going to
be
drinking
that
dirty
water,
dealing
with
it.
So,
the
difference,
if you have
a civilization
on
the coast of a river rather than where the ocean is that your sewage water is going to continue back down the river unless you can find a way to actually have your sewage water run off into, like, a marsh or something. Or, some other avenue, like a polluted lake or something. This is where you start coming up with other ideas. So,
once you get
metalworking, this is what
made ancient Assyria so great,
is that they were master metalworkers. Probably the very first master metalworkers, because they had so much experience in it. As a matter of fact, other civilizations, they traded for metal from them. Why?
Because
it was more advanced. Much more advanced. So,
I think
a lot of this plays into their lifestyle. The Greeks, what were they really good at?
Sculpting. Pottery.
Because they liked to play and have fun. The Assyrians had slaves to do this for them, and they
didn't
care what the slaves wanted.
They didn't really have any regard for slaves at all.
You were a servant. You were just expendable, so this helps in mining.
And of course, when you're mining, or you're
trying to pull metal out of the earth,
again,
engineering comes into play because you want to get better and better at it.
What are you doing when you're doing that?
At the beginning, you're just pulling the metal out of the ground. Then you're digging deeper into the earth,
and you're trying to find easier, more productive ways
of mining. Augustus Caesar, he found a pretty effective way of mining. The Romans called it hydraulic mining. Or maybe they didn't even call it hydraulic mining. Maybe somebody else called it hydraulic mining.
What is
hydraulic mining?
The hydraulic mining
that blew up a mountain in Spain,
sent gold flying out.
That's hydraulic mining. If you can figure out a way to use water to get precious
metal to come flying out of a mountain,
that's pretty advanced engineering. But it all
starts from
somewhere. Where do you get these ideas?
They all come from practice. From doing
one thing
leading to another.
It's trial and error. You need to start with water, though, so this is
where
engineering more than likely
first began. Is how could it not?
Because the first thing you need is water. So what are you going to do?
You're going to try to get it as close
to the city as possible.
You're going to
try
and
create a sewer system
because you want to get the
wastewater
out. And
once you get a knowledge of fertilization,
hey,
now you know what to do
with that.
If you can. But
what does that
require? Metalworking allows you to do so many different things
because now you can make
metal
grating. You could make
metal pipes.
And
once you get a knowledge of, hey,
and this is going to happen
sooner or later, you're going to
discover
how
to make
water
go up.
Water pressure. Rocks
built
in a certain
formation
when the water squeezes
through. Hey, look,
the water's pushing itself up
out of
the rocks.
Because it's
water pressure. And
now
the water's
moving in another
direction, upward.
You can build fountains.
So then you start
putting in
the pipes. You start mastering
water
pressure.
You start
mastering
having a
gradient
at a very good
angle.
Don't let
those guys
slip up
on this. I'm
sure
they were very careful
when they
built these
things.
Because
this is
their life
here.
This isn't like you're doing this for
somebody
else.
So
they were probably
very
aware of everything that they
were doing
when they
first
started
with
this.
Now,
forethinking,
are
you
going to
build it for
you,
or
are you going to
build
it
for
to last
for
a longer
period of
time?
So how much
land
area are
you
going
to
expend on
these irrigation
canals? You're
going
to need
them.
And it's
going
to
be
more
necessary
the larger
your
civilization
becomes.
Where
did the Assyrians
come
from?
Well,
my opinion,
they all
came from
Mesopotamia.
probably didn't like the way things were going down there, so they split up and went their own way.
Why? Because Mesopotamia was, at first, one thing,
something completely different,
and then something completely different again.
It's always constantly changing,
but the people started to become
what
feeds
whoever was in power.
They did all the work, and whoever was in power,
they were the ones
who received all the bounty of it. So, you start off with one thing, which is
a whole lot of people wanting to build
a city,
to that city having
a ruler,
to that ruler
making everybody
servants
through different methods.
Now,
the first time that you got
a real fist in your face
from this,
I'm pretty sure people
started to think about,
let's go
somewhere else and do our own thing.
You know,
when you get a whole lot of people together,
differing
opinions.
So
people who want to do their own thing,
well, why don't we just start
our own city?
Why don't we just leave?
Once you started
having
roaming
bands of
hunters,
because
these people
may have
started as hunters.
Let's just say that
they did.
Before you move on
and say, hey,
we're bad.
We could go and
kick some butt.
Let's go over here and
now we
make the rules.
So you start
building up armies.
And that's exactly what happened
in Mesopotamia.
And then
they were the rulers.
And the people
didn't like that.
So eventually
they got overthrown.
And then they
had rulers in the form
of a theocracy.
These were
the priests.
And they were,
hey,
we're not really
the bullies, but
this is what we need.
So,
pretty soon,
they're the ones
that the people are
feeding.
They didn't like
that.
Oh, here comes
another
band, another
army to
come in and take the
city.
Well,
you know what?
Let's just
get out of here
because
this whole
thing doesn't work.
Let's go build
our own city.
And eventually
that falls
under the same
rules as
the last time.
So it always
ends up with
somebody
who's
in control.
And
the rulers
in these
places
tended
to just
become lazy
and
they didn't
really
try
too hard
to please the people.
They sort of
just let them
feed
whoever was
in power.
That's where
it always
eventually
turned into.
So maybe
the Assyrians
are just another
group of
people who
left to go
on their own and
try their own hand
at
this
city
thing.
But the Assyrians
had a
different environment.
So
they
became
very
adept at
metalworking.
As a matter of fact,
they might have been
the very first
that
were really
good
at
forging
metal.
Metal
casting.
So
how does this all
get started?
And this,
of course,
will
eventually
allow
them
to
control
water on
an
unprecedented
level
because
now
you can build
pipes.
Well,
you
can build
anything.
If you could cast
into
a metal
object,
anything
you want.
Copper
is very
resistant
to corrosion,
so
if you had copper,
you could build
pipes.
It would
be resistant
to corrosion.
You
want water
that won't
stagnate?
How
about a
golden
pottery?
Golden
pottery.
How about
that?
With
a lid
on it.
Where you
close
it
airtight
for
that
long
voyage
along
the coast.
So you have
water
that
won't stagnate.
Golden
pipes.
Problem
is that
you're going to run
out of
metal
sooner or
later.
Mining
methods
would have
to be
increased.
Increasingly
increased.
Even
so that
you
could get
more and
more of
it.
Because
the need
for it
becomes
more
and more
obvious.
And
it's
not
just
for warfare.
It's going
to be
very
important
for
everything.
Once
you get
a
good
use
of metal,
you
could do
so many
things
because
now
you
have
an opportunity
to create
any
object
you want.
They
add stone,
they're
basically
sculpting
it
into
objects.
And
you build
a
stone
sword.
How good
is that
going
to look
compared to
a sword
forged
of
fine
precious
metals?
They were
the very
first
really
good
iron workers.
warriors. Of course, the Hittites.
Also.
Or to their west were very
good
metal workers,
but not as good as the Assyrians. They forged
iron, and they
were building
large armies. Earlier,
even than the Assyrians, they were building large armies.
So they were using the metal to feed those armies, while the Assyrians were building
pipes and channeling water.
Well, the Assyrians were
building pipes and channeling water.
And they were moving water.
And they were discovering water pressure and how to move water to
different areas,
different ways, so that they can use it
for anything they want,
whenever they want to use it.
And now they have it inside of the cities.
But again, we come down to the problem
of sewage water,
where you have the dirty water run off into.
So you can control the water and you can move it, but you don't have
an actual
you don't have a very good place of disposing of it,
because it's going to go back
down into the river again.
Unless you can find a
place
like a,
like I was saying, you got your sewer marsh,
and then you can use that for fertilization.
Now, how far did they go along with this?
And how good did they get at it?
The reason that
I'm saying that they did all this is
because it's necessary,
and it's
very
obviously necessary.
When they were making
buildings,
they took mud and
clay,
which they had been using,
and let it
bake in the sun,
and you have your mud
bricks.
Now you can build with that.
And
it's pretty easy to see that
they would
try other things
in
similar fashion.
Well, look.
Now we've got
this metal that
we can use.
How do we
deal with this?
We can form it into a paste.
How do we do
that?
Heat.
That's
what turns
the mud
into those bricks.
If you have
heat with metal.
Let's
just start putting this.
Somebody's going to
eventually
put in
fire, and
they're going to
have to
figure it out,
but
it's going to
take a lot of
heat to
melt
that metal.
Some
metal has
a
lot
lower
melting point
than others.
Sometimes,
actually,
metalworking
is never an exact
science,
because
maybe
the metal
you have
is more
stubborn
than the
other.
So
you
would
now
start building
these
forges.
I'm sure
that
the
first
forges
didn't
look
a lot
different
than
somebody
else's
forges
in another
area.
And not
only that,
I'm pretty sure
that
those forges
changed
a lot
through
trial and
error.
But
once you get
down
to a
certain
point
where
it's
more
and more
convenient
to do
it,
and
you've
found
a very
good
forge
that
in
a way
of forging
metal,
you're
going to
stick
with
that.
Because
you built
it,
you don't
want to
have
to
remake
another
one
if
you've
put
a
lot of
effort
into it.
But
eventually
they're going
to
get
to
a certain
point
where
you have
a very
efficient
way
of
forging
metal
objects
in
whichever
shapes
that
they want.
How
do
you
do
this
in
the
beginning?
Well,
you
take
the metal
and
you
find
a way
to make
it
melt
into
a mold,
which
you could
put
in.
It's
very
obvious.
Let's just
start with
a mud
brick
mold.
Clay
right
now.
You just
take
a metal
piece
there.
Right
out
of it.
You
can break
the
metal
mold.
Once you
put
that
in there.
So
you
can
shape
it that
way.
Who cares
about
the
mud
brick?
You
can
replace
that
easy.
The metal
object.
Now
you
have that.
So
metal
casting.
Once
you
can cast
objects
in metal.
Find
more
permanent
molds.
Something
that
you
can
reuse
over
and
over
again.
Start
to get
this
assembly
line
thing
going.
We have
different
pieces
and
you
can combine
them
together
into
stuff.
Now,
weight
distribution.
Is that coming
to play
yet?
Well,
that
is
an
important
part
of
anything
that
you
have
a large
amount
of weight
being
pushed
down,
and then
you're
going
to
be moving
this.
But
I don't
think
weight
distribution
is
actually
an
important
scenario
at this
time,
because
the first
thing that
they
did
was
they created
a gradient
for the water
to move in whichever direction. Then you start discovering water pressure, and you say, hey, we can make the water go and
we can make it
even shoot upward into the sky.
We can have
these fountains. Now those were less important than just having the water go through the city and then run out again. I'm pretty sure
people like to see stuff like that back then, so they would do it anyway.
What's important about that is that you're actually,
you're learning something.
You're advancing something there.
Put the rocks like
this, the water goes through and it shoots up into the sky. Now let's make a pipe where it does that. Let's use
metal to make that happen. Let's put valves on that so we can just
turn the valve and the water shoots out.
Now imagine what you can do. The Minoans had a very complicated structure of
water mastery.
I mean, they had a palace in Knossos with bathrooms.
And, you know, it's always up for dispute
when exactly. But
maybe around 1600
BC, that
palace,
of course,
doesn't exist
except in ruins
anymore, but
it was there,
and they
have the ruins of that palace. What a,
it's like a giant hotel. A whole city.
A giant palace.
Terraced
palace.
They had
the water
moving
through there where they can have bathrooms. Now they
have the opportunity of releasing
the water
back into
the ocean.
They're on
an
island. That's what
you want to do.
You don't want it going
downstream
to somebody
else, do you?
How are
they
going to feel
about that?
They're dirty
water.
And well, really, you have to
figure
this
stuff
out. You
can't
just
have people
doing
what they
need
to
do,
their
business, and then
you're
going
to bury
it. Mass
burying
this
over there.
And you're
leaving
that. They're
going to
try and figure out
easier ways
of doing
that. Let's
not
do it
in the
water.
So then
you start
creating
bathrooms.
So let's
start
building
buildings
with
a little
hole
in there.
The bottom of
it
that goes
into
the water
and then
the water runoff. If
you
don't have these, then
you
can't really
have
ancient bathrooms.
You gotta have
something like
that.
You
gotta
have sewer
runoff
so
that water
needs
to
go
somewhere
else.
What's
the problem
with
just having
to
go
into
a
giant
pool?
Well,
what
if the
pool
backs
up
and
the water
is constantly
running
over there?
And
you
got
a giant
overflow
of
dirty
water.
That's
why you would
want
to probably
have it
in
a marsh
area
that
feeds
into
a
fertilization.
If
you
can start
learning about
fertilization,
and
people
who lived
back
then weren't
stupid.
And
in many
ways,
they were
very
clever
and very
intelligent. So,
you
look at
a video
or something
of people
back
in
1900s
when
they
first
started
recording
people.
You
can see
actual video
of people,
and
you'll
see they're
just
like
us.
So,
these
people
back
then,
just
as real
as
you and
me,
thinking
up all
kinds
of
things
they need
to do.
But of course,
they're
beginning
to
build
a
city. So,
if you already
live in
a city, you're
not
going
to think
of
the same
things
they're
thinking
of.
You're going
to think
of
advancing
and
making
things
easier,
making
things
better.
And
it
changes
as you
create
a civil
structure.
Whichever
way you
do it.
Because
once
you
have
a
chain
of
command,
things
change
from
when you
have
everybody
working
together
for
something.
Now
you're
working
under
somebody.
And that
person
may
be
working
for
everyone's
best
interests,
or
you
may
not.
You may
not
even
see
the
big
picture
of
things.
And
maybe
you have
an
engineer
saying, well,
we need
to do this.
You may
have
an advisor saying,
we
need
to do
this.
And you
may
be like, well,
then we
need
to
do this.
And
instead,
you
might
have
a committee
of
everybody
putting
their
thoughts
together,
working
together
to
do
something.
So,
once
you have
water
moving
through
the city,
now
you can go
get
water
when
you
need
to
do
it.
If
you've got
restrooms,
you can do that.
But this
is going
to take
a long
time.
And
this
is your
first
priority.
That
and
storage
facilities.
You
might
play
a
video game
where
you
have
start
building
a city
or
something. The first thing they needed was water and food.
So food's the second thing.
You want to store food.
Whether it's a storage pit.
Whether you're using
other techniques.
Like salt.
A smokehouse. Anything
you're using for food preservation. But
very early in time, you would have granaries.
Or granaries, however you want to pronounce it.
And they're going to have infestation.
And then they're very early going to decide,
let's have these things elevated and let's make it so that we don't have infestation.
Like rats or something going into your food. Disgusting.
Nobody wants that.
And then you get the idea, hey, we don't want pests in our city.
So let's build like a wall.
No, there's palisades.
No,
then there's these walls.
The walls just to keep pests out of your city.
Walls. If you want to keep mosquitoes out of your city, you're going to use it.
Whatever methods you can to do that.
Where would you do something like that?
Well, let's go northeast of the Black Sea.
Or anywhere where there's a lot of mosquitoes.
This time you would have
Proto-Slavic people probably moving in there.
And what would they be coming up with?
Probably trying to keep those mosquitoes out of their city.
Or any type of other pests.
You don't want those snakes.
Size of shoelaces going in there.
You're going to build walls just to keep pests out around your city.
The Assyrians began with one
thing. And then they turned it into another until that it became a machine.
Working machine.
Because you have a king,
and you have everybody underneath him,
and they all know what they're doing.
And you are advancing very quickly,
very rapidly compared to
most others who are around you.
And at a certain point,
I think that they surpassed everybody,
including Egypt.
Of course, Egypt had their own problems
at a certain point.
They would have probably discovered gunpowder by 300 BC if they didn't have
a collapse.
Which occurred to them between
1200 and 900 BC.
Egypt was no longer
Egypt
that had built the pyramids.
Egypt was suffering.
And then they were easy prey for the more
vigorous
neighbors
to come in and
control
Egypt.
And I don't think
Egypt was really
the same as other civilizations
that were so intent
on progress.
I think they did it for different reasons.
The other ones
were a little bit more
nastier
about it, I think.
It's kind of like China,
which just developed these technologies.
And then you got Rome,
who was like maddening about it. They were
very
enthusiastic about progress.
But for different reasons.
So,
different civilizations do different things.
When you're in Greece,
they just wanted to have fun.
They wanted to sculpt.
So they became very good at pottery.
I think the best
ancient pottery, in my opinion,
came from ancient Greece.
Sculpting.
They were tremendous
at it.
These are more fun activities.
But when you're a servant,
you're in a civilization
with a different rule structure.
And you're going to be better at different things.
And they were good at getting the metal out of the earth.
Greece
used to go to them
to get metal.
Because they were
more advanced
metal workers.
Not only,
but they were
also
had more advancement
in getting the metal out of the earth.
And maybe the Greeks just didn't want to do that.
They were
more
into creating
things.
Being creative.
In Assyria, they had
more of a
harsh way of living,
because
you didn't have
the same freedoms that you have,
so
it's kind of like
more of a robotic way,
more of a machine,
when you have
such a
social structure as the Assyrians had.
Assyria went through a number of changes
when they became a theocracy.
When,
you know, this whole thing starts to be
built
around
Ishtar,
which is like the goddess
of war.
They became
a war society.
And then I think they
just got tired of that the other civilizations had
kicked them around.
So they started becoming
this warrior society.
And also, at this time,
the value of human life very greatly dropped
in Assyria. So they became
capable of doing the worst to another person.
And I think after they start doing stuff like that, it's a
most open
pit falling into it.
Because
you've already
done it.
So
probably drives them crazy and they do even more severe things. Kind of like you have a civilization of
mass murders.
And maybe that's exactly what they became.
And judging from the way that
they were destroyed, their civilization was destroyed
by their neighbors
who all ganged up on them
in anger, like,
you know what you did to us?
Now they're going to come back and haunt them with that forever. Because the Assyrians, they did things to people.
They used to make their
captives
from war.
Just to make them
take the bones.
That's their friends.
They had to break those bones
to dust.
They used to flay people alive.
Which is the removal of skin.
When you're still alive.
The worst thing, like having a dog collar go through somebody's head. Pulling around like that.
They had no regard for human life at all. They were master engineers. You know the Hanging Gardens of Babylon?
They built their own version.
A lot of people say
the Hanging Gardens,
those must have been pretty cool, you know, like what they looked like.
Imagine
the ones that we didn't see.
Hey,
and a lot of people don't even think the Hanging Gardens existed.
Because they think if you had
the
plants high up into
the mud bricks
up top,
the roots are going to break through it.
It's going to cause a collapse.
Well,
maybe they used metal and
the roots were
put in planters.
And maybe they took account of all that.
And maybe that
they had a system for this that we don't even realize. But the
Assyrians,
they
claim
to have built their own terrace gardens.
And they could do this.
They would use the water and have it come through these pipes, probably.
With valves and everything.
Now,
of course,
everybody wants to
find evidence of
something.
Well, there's
evidence in the fact that you require certain things to survive.
And that
means that
if you have
numerous individuals,
you require
this on a larger
scale.
Which means
that you require...
And
another thing is people think,
well,
what could they have
possibly known back then?
Well,
we lost
a lot of
what they
knew
in the Dark Ages.
And you have
to always understand
when looking at this
that there was always
a reset
in progress
because
there would be
some
civilizations
that were very
advanced and
then they would collapse.
Otherwise,
they would have discovered
gunpowder
and electricity
and all these
things.
It all
came
down to the
Romans
who controlled
basically
civilization
as far as
the
eye can see
in a large
territory.
When that broke
down,
what we know
as
the Dark Ages,
that
long
period of
time of darkness
is when
progress
was
reversed.
Even.
So
imagine
if you had a whole
bunch of
civilizations
just ran over
by darkness
and
they're all
in ruins.
They,
of course,
had
some
semblance
of
their old
life,
but this was
becoming
more and
more lost
as order
breaks
down.
Because
of the way
that
everything
had been
built
from
the Roman
control.
When
that
fell apart,
people
can now
do what
they want,
so
anarchy
can
occur.
And
when
this
happened,
there
wasn't
as
the same
kind of
cohesion.
So
the Renaissance
was
basically
all
these
civilizations
which
Rome
had taken
over,
trying
to
reclaim
this.
They
all
turned
into Rome,
and then
you had
World
War
I,
with
Rome
being
France,
Germany,
England,
they all want them to be Rome.
Except now you
have a different
situation
because of the advancements are so far
that
war is a lot different.
It's a much different creature than it used to be because back in those times, you didn't get blown to pieces.
Everybody around you so easily. As it
is
with the technology they had.
When you
were
finally at
the point
in time
where war was
something
that
was
just...
It
was very costly.
It had become
something of a nightmare.
Comparatively
to what it used to be,
it was, well, it was
probably
a nightmare
back then,
too.
So,
what would you
consider it
after that?
If you get
worse.
Very, very
difficult to
wage war with
such
a heavy
cost,
which
none of them
calculated
before
that war
exactly
how costly
it was
going to be
because
there had never
been
a war
like
it.
They
had
advanced
too much
to the point
of no
return.
Back
in those
days
when
they used to
fight
the Assyrians,
they
would
bring
in
these
giant
siege
towers,
which were capable
of crushing
these
mud
brick
walls,
and so
you can enter
the city.
I'm sure
the
walls
started
to keep
pests
out and
eventually
grew
as you
build
your
city
and you have
more
and more
people
to
do things.
So,
the
engineering
of
the
Assyrians,
of course,
started with
necessity
and built
from there
because
once
you discover these
things,
you
start
to discover
physics
and you start
to discover
how
things work
and what
you can
do and
you
can
do more. So they
had
these
giant
terraced
gardens,
they had
irrigation
canals,
they had
aqueduct
systems,
they
had
sewer systems, but not
like
the sewer
systems
you
had
in
Germania.
Oh
yeah,
they had
sewer systems,
but they were
made of wood.
Wood
rots. So,
not that Germania
was
a completely
waste-filled environment
because
they had
the best
soap out of anybody. So,
the Celts,
they
had pretty
good soap
too,
but I don't think
it was
as good
as
the German
soap.
Imagine
if
you
didn't have
soap. And
they had
their waste
removal
ideas,
but they
were not
anywhere
near as
advanced
as anybody at
this
at the time
when
they were.
When they
were
doing
these things,
everybody
else was
way
further ahead.
But
you
want to
get rid of that
smell.
You don't want people
stinking
them. You
might
get
used
to it,
so,
but
bathing
is going
to
become
an important
thing,
and that's when
you
need
to
have
a
way
of releasing
that sewage
water. You
don't
want
to drink
it,
do you?
All
of this has
to
be
calculated
and taken
into consideration.
For
your city
to grow,
you
have
to
have
that
water
moving
or
long
distances.
Can
you
imagine
if you had
to
go
walk
a half
a mile
to get a
drink
of water?
This
is not
something
that...
And you
can
keep it
in.
And
you
can keep
it. Store it.
Pottery.
Things
like
that.
But you don't
want to
be
drinking
stagnated
water.
During
the
trip
to America,
along
the Atlantic,
how's
that
when
your water
is stagnated?
And
that's
all you have
to drink.
There's
a lot
of things
that you
learn
and
then
you get
better
at over time. The
Assyrians
were able to
build
these massive
machines,
and it all started
with
the first
engineering
feats, which
were
based
on necessity.
They
built
granaries,
large
granaries,
to hold
the
massive
amounts
of...
I'm
sure
they
had
storage
facilities
not only
for
grain,
but
any
types
of
food. But of course,
you're going
to feed
these
soldiers
grain.
You want
them
to
be
tough.
You don't want
them
to be spoiled.
So we're
just
going to
feed
them
grain.
You're going to
eat
it.
You
can
go
and
kill your
enemy.
Massive
arms
is what
they
created.
These
armies
had
stuff
that
nobody
had
seen
before.
What's
that?
The horsemen.
They
had chariots. Just
like
the
Egyptian
chariots.
Because they
had advanced
to the
level
where
you
had
less
of
a
chance
of
this thing
toppling
over,
where they
were
more
mobile.
They
made
rafts
to cross
rivers,
of course,
to move
their army.
Julius
Caesar
built
a
bridge in
a
very
short
amount
of time.
Built
these
giant
wooden
palisades.
All
these
things
that
he
built.
Assyrians
didn't
necessarily
do
that,
but they
had
granaries
situated along their path to any direction, basically. Let's be able to move the army.
Let's have armories here.
Let's be able to mobilize our forces very quickly. What did these guys do when they weren't at war? How professional an army was this?
Well,
one thing that Assyria was when they were under the theocracy was
they
were very good at farming and of
taking
care of the land.
They did
a very good job of those things
because
they
had
such experience at it, at irrigation, and they were very advanced.
So they
probably were able
to have quite an abundance
of food in the form of what was available to their
terrain,
to their
area, and trade. Who wanted
to trade with
them? Who didn't want
them to come over there and tear their faces off?
That's what they used to do.
They
created
quite an aura of intimidation.
But
they weren't
really
necessarily known as a great trading civilization.
So, you know,
let's see what we got to eat here. Of course, though, when you're conquering these different areas,
now
you got people.
Not only
are they
giving you what they
had, but
get tribute
from the ones that are
scared
out of their minds.
See
this in
Persia.
They were bringing
them
gifts. Sort of like
you had
a
pecking on
civilizations at
certain
points. One time,
they were the
biggest
bully
was Assyria.
You got your
lunch money? Well, that's
Assyria.
They will take your
lunch
money.
And they
won't say another word
about it until you
don't
pay them.
Might willingly
give them
your lunch money, and they start
demanding
that you give
them
it
on
a regular
basis.
So
they probably felt
extremely
tough because
they were going
around
kicking
people's butts.
They had good
ideas,
like you got
your archers,
but
now you got
guys
who just
held shields
in front
of them.
So you want to
destroy their archers?
Well, that's a
very
important
thing
in a
warfare.
As a matter of fact,
if
it was
me,
the main thing
you got to do, you got to destroy
their
missile
weapon.
And
you have to
do that very
quickly
because
whoever ends up in an
infantry
battle,
whoever has
the extras,
you
have
a huge advantage.
So you want to
destroy
their cavalry
and you
want to destroy
their
missile
forces.
You want to
stand
there getting
pelted,
destroyed.
The easiest
way to
destroy archers
is
if you have
a cavalry,
a heavy
cavalry.
You don't
want
these little
wimpy
cavalry.
You want
a giant
fist.
But they weren't really
thinking
like that back
then.
I mean,
horsemen had
just
come around
in Assyria, and that was
just
a modification
of
the chariot.
Now you just
have
a single guy,
and they
were
using bows and arrows, so you just got
missile
troops
that were
moving around
the battlefield.
These
were more,
these were
less
organized,
of course,
than
later
on,
later
times.
Because
the enemy
was
less organized.
You could
get away with
it.
And,
you know,
there's lots of
the trial
and error of
warfare
and different
ideas
and tactics
as far
as that
goes
and where that
had
advanced to.
Did they
just
run over their
enemies?
Just
run them
over
with force?
Sure,
that's what
they
did
most
of the time.
Because
there
really
wasn't
any
great
resistance
to
them.
It's not like
they
had
Napoleon
Bonaparte
as
a neighbor.
Or Alexander
the Great.
Or any
of these
great
military
geniuses
who are
thinking
about
luring
them into
a
trap
and then
surrounding and destroying them
in good
order.
And
that's
the main
thing
that
you want to
do,
especially
when
you're facing
a
larger army. Destroy
a piece
of it at a
time.
Distract
them
and destroy
them
a piece of
a
time. That was
the
whole thing
that
Alexander and
the
and this is
basically
his dad
who
created
that,
his father
who created
the
very
good
way of
doing
that
is you have
this
giant force of
what they had. Like, you have something, if you have an unassailable position, and your enemy is concentrating on that, and then you have something that's
very quick
and powerful going around the battlefield, and this
is destroying pieces of the enemy army while they're trying to take on that more unassailable position. They're wasting their time on that while you're picking apart their army. That was
what was the key to Macedonian warfare. That's how
it was supposed to work.
Most of the time in history with that style of warfare, it was not executed properly.
It could have been.
But it wasn't. Did the Assyrians use this type of warfare to destroy their enemies?
I don't think so.
They didn't have that type of an army. So they probably just used brute force and ran over the enemy.
Then they were very cruel in
victory. So it's basically saying
you don't want to
mess with us.
So just do what we say and that's it. And
most people did. Eventually they got sick of it.
They all ganged up on them. And they were probably just as cruel to
the Assyrians,
being self-justification that they were
this way to everybody else, so this is what they get. So let's just be that way to them. Now, of course,
there was a lot more cool things that they did.
I don't know
if
the Mycenaeans were
as cool as the Assyrians.
I mean, this whole thing where you're gonna feed him his family
and then tell him about it later.
Oh yeah, by the way,
you know, that's your little nephew there that you just ate in that
pie I baked for you.
You don't do stuff like that.
But
they did stuff like that.
There was a lack of value of human life back in those times.
In those civilizations.
And that really makes
other people angry, you know, so
what they do is
they end up holding a grudge and
when they get the chance to act on it.
That's what happened to Assyria. They were drowned in enemies.
And they just fell apart.
At that point,
the Assyrians would end up becoming a part of
the giant
Persian Empire.
When the Persians
swept all the way into Egypt,
they became a much, much more tolerant and a much less, much less of a giant fist.
But they were still pretty much of a bully.
But of course, they learned a lot.
So they didn't want to be another
Assyria. They did different things
to make sure that
people probably didn't look at them that way. So Assyria was a very
warlike civilization
at this point. They became a war. You know what? They
might have been
the very
first
warrior society.
You know,
if you have a civilization reach a certain point
of advancement where you could actually say
that. I mean,
would you
consider a
warrior society
just a couple of tribes
that are,
but they really
took this thing to the next level.
They made a professional army
that was trained
to be
a machine.
They had tactics.
Like I said, they probably just ran over people because
what kind of
tactics
you can have
based on what kind of army that
you're
using
and how many
soldiers
you have and
also their level of
discipline.
I'm sure they
had a
pretty high level
of discipline,
but I know
it wasn't as good
as a
level of discipline
as you
might have
with
a different type
of army
structure.
If you have
a phalanx,
you're going to have
a more of
a discipline structure
than
you're going to have
with
a wide open
formation.
Because
it's okay
for you
to
basically
just
go over there
and,
you know,
tear
the guy's face
off
and attack
whoever
you want
to
do, whoever
you want
to attack next.
In a phalanx,
you have
a lot of
rules
that
you have
to be
just
from
that. Just
from
the formation
that
you're
in. So, if you had this type of war machine there, more than likely, you would use your archery
to...
You know, the softening noble, the enemy with archery, is really what got a lot of... Got a lot of armies defeated.
Because it's
just to soften up the enemy. If you want to really win and really conquer,
you don't
just soften up the enemy with archery.
You make them
chase your archers all over the battlefield. And that's when you strike with your
fist.
That's when you bring in that
the infantry
and the cavalry.
The cavalry comes in.
Should
be
the order. You destroy them with your archery from afar. You make them chase them around.
And then you
bring in your
infantry
to engage them.
And then your cavalry comes out of nowhere and destroys all of their missile troops.
Destroys everything else that they have, leaving just the infantry. And then they just come in from behind and they destroy their infantry. Of course, you didn't have that type of cavalry.
So
maybe they just
use
their archery at the start of the battle.
Their chariot archers,
and I'm pretty sure they had them
use it to light everything that they had at the beginning.
And then the enemy probably chased them around
to no avail.
Chased the horsemen around
to little avail.
Tried to fire in all directions.
And then at a certain point,
the infantry.
Of course, this is going to change
with the numbers that are involved in these things.
Because the larger number, a larger skill of
battle,
you have to
control the
enemy as well. You have to
keep them at base.
You have to
commit more troops
to,
this is all
based upon how many
troops your enemy has.
So you have to
commit as many
troops as
necessary,
because if
you don't want
them to have
squadrons
running around
to the back of
your
infantry.
So you always have to
keep them occupied.
So
war
is controlling
your enemy's
numbers.
But if you
can
create a situation
where you have
one unassailable
position
and the enemy
is attacking
that,
and then
the rest of your
army
can just
go and pick
them off
one at a
time,
that
is
the most
successful
approach
to warfare
in
any situation
up
until
World War
One.
You know,
maybe,
and then
I don't
know how
exactly
effective
any
type of strategy
could
be
as far as
those
same
tactics,
because
it's changed
because
of the
level
of
destruction
that can
be unleashed
through artillery
bombardments.
I mean,
if
you know
how
to properly
unleash
artillery
and to
use that,
you
can destroy
and
crush
an enemy
before
they can ever
reach you.
You
can have
an enemy
scared
to death
to run
through that
fire.
That
if you can
have
an
area,
just
a
dead zone,
where
you
run
through there
and you're
suffering
such
severe
casualties,
and
so many
of you are
dying,
just
blown
to pieces,
using
just
artillery
itself.
The
best
way
to
deal
with
artillery
is you have
to hurry
up and
get
to it and
destroy
it.
It's not a
thing
where
you
can
just
get
through
unscathed.
You
gotta
take
losses
to do
those
sorts
of things.
Unless you have
an
aerial
strike,
which
takes
care
of
the enemy
artillery.
Or you
have
your
own
artillery
destroy
their
artillery.
So
artillery
was
a huge
part of
modern
warfare,
and it
is
a lot
different.
Even now,
of course,
now
it's a
lot different
than
it would
be
in
World War
One
or
World War
Two,
because
now
you've got
a lot
of
different
technology.
But
of course,
artillery
is
mass
destruction.
What
about
artillery?
They
had those
siege engines
for destroying
the light brick
buildings
and getting
in there.
Catapults,
those
types
of things.
The Assyrians
were
more of
a
hands-on
war
machine.
So
they
just
got their
hands
dirty.
They
didn't
just
attack
you from
a distance,
but
I'm sure
that
they
used
their
chariots
and
their
horsemen
to
put
them
to good
use.
You don't
want to
waste
those
things.
But
I
think
they probably,
their
infantry
wouldn't
just
didn't
want
to sit
back
there.
They
wanted
to get
in
there
and
start
smashing some people. They were probably experienced
and
very
vicious,
and whoever survived
probably became mentally
scarred. So, you know,
he's gonna
get out there and
bite somebody in the face or
gouge their neck or something with
their teeth. Rip their
Adam's apple out or something.
It's very vicious. So,
the Assyrians, they were master engineers because
they were able to
create
these giant waterworks.
They had
massive
granaries, but how much engineering does it
take to
build a giant
mud brick building?
Well, they built some pretty amazing buildings. Of course, you have
this
waterway, which has to be just
expanded upon
because you want it to look nice, so you start adding to it.
Whoa,
look at here. Now you have this
waterway,
well-designed, looking
very prestigious,
and these buildings.
Architecture.
Start building,
and you start
understanding
weight
distribution.
How do you understand
weight distribution?
You could have
a single person holding
a very heavy
object, and
he could
tell you where the
stress
is.
You put,
grab
something, hold up
something that's
heavy,
find out where
the stress
is being pushed,
and you
can discover a lot from that.
So you started
testing
it out.
Let's see where
the
stress
being pushed
on this. Now, earthquakes play a part in this too, because once you have our earthquake
terror
building down,
huh?
Of course, you
get to a
point
where
you say,
buildings
build a Lego
will stand
more than this building of solid stone
because
they move with
the earth.
Yeah, something like that. Let's just
have it like
pieces of
it
that move.
They're all moved
together.
Earthquake
proof. So,
what do you
think
of doing
it?
Of course.
If you have
an earthquake,
tear
down
your
building.
In Turkey,
they have
a lot of earthquakes, so
they would
be thinking about making
a building
earthquake
proof
at some point. Well, let's
build it so it
can fall
apart again.
They're not
going to
be stupid. They're
going
to try
something
else. They're
going to
try and
figure out
a way
to keep
it standing. Well,
let's see.
We've got cracks
here.
This thing
is completely
collapsing
on
itself.
Huh.
Maybe
if this
piece
moves by itself
and this piece
moves by
itself.
Okay,
weight
distribution.
What's
the best
way
to control
weight
distribution
is to
separate
the pressure
to
different
pieces.
So,
like
an
assembly
line
for
a building
is
a good idea,
a good
way to go. Because
if you could
have
one
solid
stone,
but
if you
could
divide
that
into
six
different
pieces
with
the stress
being
placed on
each individual
six pieces
of
less
of
the building
is
being placed
upon
those different
pieces.
Well, say
that
you
just
had one solid
stone,
so you
cut
it into
six
different pieces. Okay.
And
each one
of those
had the
pressure
of
another
six pieces.
But
the pressure
of
the piece,
whatever's
connected
to
that,
rather than
the
entire
stone
on top
of
it.
The
Colossus,
when the
roads,
when
they say,
because the
legs
spread
apart,
is impossible
because
everything
that's
in the middle
is
going to fall
straight
down
because
of the
way that
you're
building
it.
It's
just
not
structurally
sound.
But what if
they
found
a way
to divide
the
weight
distribution?
I don't
think that's
how they
did
the pyramids.
Moved them
or anything. But I think
that
happened there
that they
found
a way
to
reform
the stone
to
possibly
turning
the same
stone
into a
paste
and letting
it melt
back into,
you know,
like
using
mud
brick. But
they
took
the stone
and
then
they grinded
that
same stone
into
a paste.
So then
it's
order,
like
they
could just
put it
into
into as much of a paste form as you can.
Put it in there, and you let it heat up
together,
and hey, it just somehow reforms into these giant stones. Instead of just
dragging these
giant stones, and how do you get those ones that are up on top?
Maybe it was different pieces,
and they found a way to make the stone
to turn
those
stones
into a stone slab from individual pieces.
It's just a theory.
They
found a
way to make it to make stone
reform itself
through using
paste.
It's
the
same stone
as a paste,
and letting it heat
back
into,
you know,
back into the other stone.
It's like a mortar
between
the
two,
and then
it's like,
you know,
when
it dries
up,
it just looks
like
one big giant
stone slab.
You can figure
out
a way to
do that.
Instead
of moving
these
giant,
basically
giant
houses
of stone,
putting
one on top
of another.
How do you
do that?
I don't care
what
kind of
pulleys
and
levers
and
whatever
methods
that you
have of
moving
weight
distribution.
It's
even
just
to think
about
horses,
the hair
necessary
for
a rope,
what
you would
need
for
the rope
that
they
would
have
needed.
And that's
not
good.
It's not
going to
work.
Well,
any
type
of
thing
is going to
require,
it's
going to
require
a lot
that
they probably
didn't
even
have,
so
maybe
that they
just
let
the,
you could
just
turn
into
a
paste
form.
Just
let
it,
let
it
turn
back
into
solid
stone.
Part of
the slab.
It's the same
exact stone.
It's just
been
obliterated
into
a paste
between
the cracks.
So that
when
it hardens,
it's
all one
giant
stone
slab.
If
that's
the
way
they
did
it. I don't know
if that's
the way
they did it,
but that's just
a theory.
So there's
a
lot
of
information
on
ancient
Assyria.
They
had,
of course,
great
leaders
like
Ashurbanipal.
That
people
know
that
he created
these
libraries
where
he wanted
to
keep
all
of
the
great
stories
of the
time.
Or just
maybe
what he
preferred
as far as
which
writings.
Maybe
he discarded
ones
that
he didn't
like
or
was
possibly
offended
by.
Or maybe
he kept
them all.
Maybe
he wanted
to have
as much.
Maybe
he thought
that
everything
you read
is a good
read.
Wanted
to
keep
everything
on
these
stone
tablets
that
they
had
in
this giant
library.
That
he had
the first
great
library. So
he was
probably
trying
to build
something
that
nobody
had ever
seen
before.
Like,
you know,
like,
I want to
be
the,
I want
people
to
remember
me
and look
what
I
did.
You know,
the other
leaders that
they
had
were
probably
not
too
far off
from
that
way
of
thinking,
but
you
have
to
have
time
of peace
to
pursue
other
things,
and
if
you're
constantly
embroiled
in
warfare,
that's
going to
be
your
primary
concern,
especially
if you're involved
in
the
deployment
of troops,
which
Ashurbanipal
was,
I'm sure,
most
of
the time
in charge
of,
because
he
was
actually
a
real
hands-on
guy.
He
was
involved
in
a lot
of
different
things.
And,
he
didn't
just
sit back
and
let other people
make
decisions
for
him.
Now,
the cruelty
of the
Assyrians
may
have
been
the
highest
level
of
any
civilization.
That
could
be
disputed,
but
I don't
know
how
you could
get
it
any more
than
them.
But
they were
also
masters
of engineering.
They
had
the
opportunity
to
go
far
beyond
that,
of course,
had
they
not
been
attacked
from
all
directions,
basically,
and
crumbled
under
their
enemies.
But
the
Assyrians
were,
and they
had
the
legacy
of
what
they
did.
However
you
want
to
look
at
it,
from
the
good or
bad,
probably
more
a lot
more
bad
than
good
when you look
at
it.
When
you
got
them
talking
about telling their enemies they're going to eat their own excrement. That's just disgusting. How do you put a smiley face on that?
You really can't.
But if you look at Marvel at their great engineering feats,
the most engineering came from established civilizations
that had spent a long time working on this stuff. There's a lot of interruptions in different places.
I should be looking at these notes that I have, because, you know, like,
I spend a lot of time looking at
this giant
picture that is painted by these different civilizations
and the different things that
they deal with. You have a lot of different changes
in living
that go on
through time. You know, if you think back to a certain time period in your life,
it has
a
different feeling than other times. So imagine what the life of one of these Assyrian people must have felt like on a day walking around, smelling the air, walking
through
the buildings to the, maybe to the
friends
to go and see
what the big
story of the day.
Where would they gather at?
Well, there was probably
an area where they all,
everybody has their hangouts, you know, people are kind of territorial.
So you go and meet with
people and you discuss what's going on in your spare time. Maybe
after work, go and hang
out and talk about what's going on in Assyria. Or maybe just what's going on in that individual city.
Nineveh
was not known as being a place of justice.
It was
known as a
where you can
go and have your
belongings
become somebody else's belongings. No matter
what belongings they were,
you could become somebody else's belonging.
This is also Nineveh after the Persian Empire.
Nineveh
became
what would be in Star Wars a hive of scum and villainy.
So the
Assyrian collapse
may have had a lot to do with that. You know,
probably a lot of people were sorrowful and drunk. Didn't care about anything at that point.
Talking about the
good old days.
But
in the good old days
in Assyria,
they were probably full of life and vigor, and
the exploits of Assyria were probably
a fine topic of conversation. So let's
look at my notes here that I
take.
Okay, let's see. Let's talk about
some of the
things
going on
in their times.
The times
of Assyria.
Some
of the
exciting
events
from across
the world.
They didn't
have that news
for
it.
Maybe they probably had a news reporter.
Maybe they had
a
series
of
news
reporters
who all worked
in unison. Let's see what's
going
on
in the world
around
them.
Oh, well, you
first
have to deal
with the
Hittites, of
course.
We're pretty
powerful.
Now, they
fell
apart
about
the same time
as
Egypt,
so
might want
to blame that
on the
same people,
because
some
people
do.
The
sea people.
Same
people,
the sea people.
Who had
these big
giant swords.
See,
how did that
work?
What happened with
the sea people?
You would
go to
hit them
with your sword,
and they would
hit your sword
with their
sword, and their
sword
would destroy
your
sword,
and then
they cut
your
face
off.
Your head
off, too.
Well,
whichever
order.
Probably
like
playing
T-ball.
Okay,
let's
look
here and
see what
you
have.
Oh,
openly
hostile
invaders.
Other
people don't
like
society
because
it just
didn't
work
out
for them,
so
you get a
bad
taste
in
your mouth.
What
do?
They become
raiders.
Well, they have
this
happens
a lot
during this
time of
history.
You have
justification
of
violence.
Okay,
so
the
Hittites
were
to the
west
of
Assyria.
And
they were
pretty
powerful. at points of conflict between the two. Before time. Assyria
was not
a great power to destroy the Hittites or to be a serious threat to them
until after they built their great empire
when the Hittites were no longer in existence. However, there's always a civil unrest that occurs
in the areas around Assyria.
And that greatly affects them. Because when the Hittites fell apart, you had all these new civilizations coming in. They started fighting with each other. And warfare became something that was very important because
these guys just couldn't get along with anybody.
Once you have these
civil unrest,
you don't like these people around you.
You start talking bad about them.
Mesopotamia was filled with civil unrest. During the time of progress in Egypt, civil unrest within Mesopotamia started to unravel.
Whereas
Egypt was actually conquered to a certain extent by the Assyrians. Just look into my notes here, make sure that I cover as much as I have from here.
You gotta get that stuff for clothes, you know.
You wanna trade for fine linen? You wanna have some nice clothes? You don't have silk.
What textiles do you have for clothes?
You have
guys in
furs always make you look tough.
You got a giant fur, you cut a
bear up,
you get this giant cloak on.
Just make yourself look pretty tough here.
Then when you want to
make clothes over a large
area
of person,
equaling
that you want to
create
a massive amount
of
uniform, basically.
So that
you create
a certain
type
of attire
that everybody wears.
But you need
to
have
the resources
to do this.
There's different
levels
of obtaining
a
resource
because
you have
the level
where
you trade
it for a few
or
you have an agreement
with somebody
to bring in
these
en masse
to
your civilization
for clothes.
Clothes
are
important.
Well,
maybe most
people
just want
to walk
around
naked
and get
a nice
tan
or a nice
sunburn.
You know,
get
used
to the sun
and
your skin
over
time might
be
really
dark
and
used
to the
sun
as well.
Imagine
having
to
constantly
be sunburned
all
the time.
You would
want
to cover
yourself
to
protect
yourself
from
it. But
the
Assyrians,
they
were pretty
resistant
to the
sun,
and they were probably
walking
around
with
rags
around
them.
They
didn't really
have
a fancy.
They
didn't have
this
fancy
style
of living
amongst
the
normal
everyday
person.
Probably
went
out
almost
practically
naked
and
talked
to his
friends.
Let's
see what
else.
Yep,
talk to myself
while I
read this.
There was
a lot of
animals
that
weren't
around
for
too long
in
certain areas.
Maybe
they
had
elephants.
You
might see
in
a video game
there's
elephants
in
Assyria.
They had
elephants.
They
were
smaller
elephants,
if I
recall
correctly.
They
want to
cast
metal
and
make
these
things
look
really
cool.
They want
their army.
That's one
thing
when
people
look
back
at
history.
Well, the
practical
uses,
like
everything,
clothing,
it's not
always
for practical
uses.
You want to
look tough.
You want to
look cool.
That's
the
normal
part
of
it.
That would
be
like
going
ahead
years
from
now
and saying
that
some
person
in
a
rap
video,
why
did
he wear
that
hat
to
start?
Probably
for
aerodynamic
reasons.
No,
he
wanted
to
look
cool.
You
didn't think
they
thought
different
back
then.
They said
smart
because
they
didn't
cover
their
blood.
No.
They
wanted
to
look
tough.
They
wanted
to
look
cool.
If you have
an
army
like
them
trying
to
be
as
tough
and intimidating,
Of course you're going to have a crimson cloak. You're going to look like you're...
the embodiment of an enemy's nightmare. You want to be
scary.
Put fear in them. You just want to look cool just for your own sake. So when you think of yourself doing the slaughtery in the battle,
you want to look at yourself and think, man, I must to look cool. Not the word they use, I'm sure. But
they want
to look good.
So there was a warlord hierarchy that basically started things in
this region.
Because after you split off
from
civilization,
and you have this hatred of civilization
because you tried it and it didn't work for you, eventually
somebody takes control of that,
and now you have a warlord hierarchy. So you're
basically
back to the
civilization, but in a smaller form.
And these guys would end up going around and even harassing the Assyrians.
Sea peoples would foray
into various areas as raiders.
That's what they say about them. Including
Egypt.
Let's go
to the Sinai Peninsula. Sure, they
probably encountered the turquoise miners.
The Egyptian turquoise miners. They would probably go
where there was less somebody
taking advantage of the situation.
Okay, let's see.
The Mitanni.
M-I-T-T-A-N-I. That
would come
into contact with the Assyrians.
And these guys would go toe-to-toe for quite some time before the massive Assyrian Empire
could just
go
over there and
send an army to crush them. Which they would end up being able
to do.
There's a certain point in time where you create
an alphabet
of sorts,
but
you start
with
hieroglyphics.
Start with
a certain type of writing
where you have
a symbol
represent
something, or you have an alphabet like the
Phoenicians.
The Phoenicians had the first alphabet.
Phonetic,
you know.
So the Phoenicians, they were not too far off from the Assyrians.
You
develop an alphabet,
and you
pretty much
kind of
coincide
that with
a mathematical
system,
because
you have
an alphabet,
you're going
to start
putting
numbers
into
a system.
Cisterns
are
pretty
important
of
these cities.
If you
can have
pools
of water
for any
different purpose,
city
planning
comes into play
anytime
you start
using
cisterns.
Because
where are you
going to
put them? Where are you
going to
build this?
Where are you
going to
build
that? Where are you going to
put
this fancy
building?
City
planning
with
writing.
You start
carving
these
tablets
a blueprint.
When
you start doing
that?
If you
can
refine
your
lifestyles
to a
system
that
works,
you
usually
keep
that
system.
Because
it's hard
to change
when you have
all
the
fish
moving
in the same
direction.
It's hard
to stop
them
and turn
them
around,
push them
the other
way,
or
you
got all the
wheels
moving,
it's hard
to
get
in the way
of them.
Say, wait a
minute, go that
way.
Cave
bears.
Were
they around?
Did they see
any of these
giant
bears
with the small
heads?
Now there's
something,
you kill
an
accident,
you go out
to hunt.
See
something like
that.
And the thing is
stabbing
you nowadays.
You're not
ready
to kill
a giant
bear like
that, but when you were hunting
back then,
you coincidentally
you
have
a weapon.
That would be
something
that
would
come out.
Well, maybe
if you
knew
about
it, you
might go and
look for
it. So you
can prove
yourself.
You'd probably
kill
it on
accident
even
under
those
circumstances,
because
you would
go
along
with
it
to
look
tough, but
once you
see
the
thing,
you're like,
ugh. Tries to maul somebody who
gets
stranded,
you
end up killing
them on
accident.
I think you had
that
spear
with
them. Gardens,
if you
can do
that,
you
need water,
of course.
But
once
you
have that,
you
can
learn
how
to plant.
Because
you have
horticulture,
it's
just
using
the
plants
that
are already
there.
Agriculture
is
when you start
to
change the nature.
You start to grow it where you want to grow it. You can grow
whatever you want to grow, you can create a garden.
So when you can grow those,
your city just hits another level of culture.
Go and look at the garden.
You could go over there and have your lunch.
Of course, these things would be continually enhanced.
Most perfect as you could get.
I think people would.
They wouldn't want to stop making those things better.
You have to have
something to do with your free time, too, so.
They didn't go roller skating.
The Kassites. Another group. Probably were hated by
just about everybody. And
up in the hills around Babylon,
you
were like the
first Persian
seeds being planted by east
of Babylon
by all the little tribes
coming together. The hills over there.
These would be the types of,
these would be the people,
when you call them the
Medes,
M-E-D-E-S,
you know, I read all this,
so I don't watch these documentaries
as much as I read
everything I
get my hands on,
but these guys would go in there, and make
raids,
probably,
into civilization,
probably didn't
like civilization,
there were probably some of those that left, living
a more harder lifestyle,
something like the Greeks lived, you know, like, you know, more harsh terrain. Then
these guys came together, and
the Persian Empire basically
starting to build
itself at the time of the Assyrian collapse.
They probably were inspired
by this, their part they played in the destruction of Assyria.
There's also a financial crisis
that occurs when you start
to use more than you're getting,
so
you always got to find a way
to
change this
and to alter
this
to your advantage.
Warfare is one way of doing that, is
going and getting
more resources.
If you don't have enough
to do what you need to do
with it,
or if you want
something somebody else
has,
you can trade
for it,
or you can go and get it for
yourself.
You can ask them
to deliver it to you
through negotiation,
whether with a sword
or with
a bargaining
agreement
where both can
benefit from.
And I'm
pretty sure that I'm almost at the end of this.
Well, I'm sure I am,
because I'm not going to go too much further with this.
What
place do women have in a Assyrian society?
If you have a war society,
that's one thing.
Ishtar,
the goddess of war.
That's the leader.
So they serve.
It's a woman.
It's actually
a statue of a woman.
And then you have
women
underneath there.
And they look at them
and say, wow.
This is like,
she
reminds me of
Ishtar.
The guys
go out and do all the fighting, of course.
Probably
think the women
are tough.
Just because
they're Assyrian.
The guys are so
tough, then
the women
gotta be tough
too.
Women
really
played
a smaller
role
in civilizations
of
Mesopotamia
and
in all societies
around that area.
In
Egypt,
a woman could do more,
I think.
And
it's all based
upon,
you know,
I think
the
leisurely lifestyle
is,
I think, women
are able
to
not be bullied
so much,
you know, because
physically
the guys
bullying the women
and saying,
you know,
like
we get
the things the way
we want it.
More
leisurely
type of
civilization
is going
to allow women
to
not
be
bullied.
It's basically
bullying the women.
That's
how you get
the guys
doing,
getting
all the glory
in
the women.
They
just gotta
stay at home
and sew
or something.
So
maybe the women
were making
these nice
costumes
for the
guys
to walk around in,
or the
guys were still walking
around,
pretty much
naked,
basking
in the sun,
going
and sticking
their feet
in the cisterns,
to get your feet out of there and drink from that. Slave labor would be doing most of the mining, because that's the stuff you just don't want to do. So that's what you use the slaves for.
He had them build road networks to connect everything so they could move his massive army from one place to another and
know exactly where he's going.
You know, if you don't know where you're going, you know,
imagine walking through this giant forest and you don't have a road. What a pain it is.
When you have a road, it's much nicer.
The terrain around the area.
When you get to Damascus, it's actually beautiful around Damascus, I think.
And back then,
it was much more beautiful, probably.
Well, I'm sure it was
more beautiful.
A lot more beautiful.
You could just look up in the sky and see all the stars. They must have felt like the richest people in the world.
Especially when you have
less people.
So there was a lot of free
things that they were able to do that would probably for them to
use for their spare time. Buildings,
a lot of those places. You go to the roof and you're in part of the house
when you're on the roof,
because they would actually make that into part of the house.
The roof. I mean,
you could sleep on the roof and look up at the stars and you get a little farther going. Drink some wine. Talk about whatever it comes to mind, probably.
Philosophizing.
Even though people say that the Greeks
invented it, they probably had
a level of philosophy themselves. A level of theology themselves.
You know.
Of course, and then they believe that Ishtar, or whatever they believe about her.
I wonder
what Ishtar thinks about me.
There's a lot of
gods in the Mesopotamian. I'm not just saying that there's
just
Ishtar,
because the Mesopotamian religious system is which the Assyrians were a part of,
was
a very complicated. Because
it was basically
the way that it works is that you
make sure that I'm saying this right. Mesopotamian religious system.
They had
a system for the way that they believe everything.
Chaldeanism.
How do you spell that? Chaldeanism. Chaldeans. So the religion would be named after.
Oh, whatever. Think it was something like,
spirit
is reborn
through discovering the gods. Did you discover them? You're fulfilling your role or something?
I don't think
it was that stupid. Let me see here. Sure. Religion. What's the dude religion?
Yeah, the Mesopotamian. Ancient Mesopotamian religion. Survive.
Right.
Their
beliefs.
And they also would pick a patron
of the deities. You know, like Ur and
Uruk?
They were big temple cities, and they would all dedicate themselves
to a different god. And it's all played into the Assyrians,
because they still kept the same type of religious
structure.
They just had their own god, and this is the one.
But
Assyria
was under
Ishtar. You know, like
she just
picture
what she looks like.
She looks like
she looks pretty peaceful,
actually. You
know, she
looks kind of clever.
She looks like she might
actually be enjoying herself
watching
this whole bloodbath
ensue.
See, that she's
a goddess of fertility,
love, war, and sex.
She's the
X-rated goddess.
And
they built stories around that,
but
well, now I don't really want to look at this right now. I just want to say what they,
the way it works, you know, like.
Okay. Duty and ritual, more than morality.
I believe that man originated as a divine act of creation,
and the gods were believed to be the source of life, and held power over sickness and health, as well as the destinies of men.
Personal names show that each child was considered a gift from divinity. Man was believed to have been created to serve the gods or perhaps wait on them.
Was the Lord.
And man
is servant or slave and was to
fear the gods
and have the appropriate attitude towards them.
It is to have been
primarily of a cultic
and ritual nature.
Although some prayers express
a positive
psychological relationship or a sort of conversion experience in regard to a god.
Generally, the reward
to mankind is described
as success in long life.
Well, you know what
they think about their lives
in Mesopotamia?
Gilgamesh
is over there having sex
with their wives on their
wedding night.
They hated their lives.
Did
the Assyrians feel the same way?
Dude,
the kings of Assyria
have the same attitude.
Just
say,
abuse
the people below them.
Take
what we want
for ourselves.
If you don't
like it,
you'll
disappear.
Nobody
will ever see
you again.
Sin,
on the other hand,
was expressed
through
different words.
Mistake,
false
step,
rebellion,
sin
or curse,
with strong
emphasis
on
the idea of
rebellion.
Sometimes
with the idea
that
sin
is man's
wishing to live
on his own
terms.
Well, you know what?
That
sounds a lot
like these
theocracies.
So
that didn't
work out
too well
when they
had the
bullies
in there,
and then
when
these guys,
they want
to, of course,
do what
there's,
you know,
we got
here,
or
where are
this
thing
called life
supposed
to take
us,
didn't
they?
They're
over there,
they're
eating all
this good
food,
and
out
of these
nice
metal
containers,
with
it, they're
taking
a little
piece
of everybody,
you know?
These
priests,
they're telling
them,
sin,
rebellion,
terrible
ideas,
and
you bring
me some more
of that,
good.
Oh,
I
really
would
like
to have
that
over there,
but
yeah,
don't
you dare
do that.
A number
of examples
of
Mesopotamian
literature
show
how war
and natural
disasters
were
treated
as punishment
from
the gods
and
how kings
were
used
as
a tool
for
deliverance.
So, you know,
it's just
like
what
I said.
All plain
in the
hands
of
the
guy
taking
control
of the
society
and
just
not
doing
his job
because
you're supposed
to lead
him.
But
you just
want
to sit there
and party,
basically.
They
all wanted
to party.
And
the other
people,
they're
working.
They're
over there
partying.
They
don't live
in their
mom's
basement.
They
live
at
the top
of
the
castle.
They
didn't have
a castle,
but
they had
a pretty
nice
palace.
They
had these
ziggurats,
which were
used
as
courthouses,
basically.
You
know,
like,
what
you see
in
the
cultures
that
were
in America
before
Christopher
Columbus,
before
Spain,
before
any of
that,
before
Hernan
Cortez.
This
is like the
same
stuff
you
see here.
They
had
probably
heads
toppling
out of
those ziggurats
for
public
sacrifices.
And these
all
change,
of course,
over
time.
Whatever
it was.
In
style.
These
were
giant
courthouses,
these
ziggurats.
Okay,
they
did
have
a lot
of trade
going on
in some
of these places
where
pretty
big
trading
centers
at the
time.
So
when you think
of
the guys
who lived
back
then,
just
think
of
them
as
you
and
me.
Same
deal.
There
were people,
they
lived,
you
saw
video
of
it.
That
would be
the thing
that would
really
convince
you. So
you
want
to think
about
ancient
Assyria?
Imagine
if there
was a
video
of them
back
then
somehow.
If it was
a black
and white,
it
would probably
seem
more real.
If you saw
it in
any other
color
or something,
you'd
probably
think
it just
looks
like
a
movie
too much.
Especially
if you saw
it
on Blu-ray.
So
whichever way
you need
to picture
it to
see
it
as
real
as.
But
imagine
if somebody
actually
had video
footage
of
the
Assyrians
around,
I don't know,
700
BC.
Under
this giant,
massive
war
machine,
this
juggernaut
of
raging
power.
So these guys, you see them on your phone.
You're looking at the video.
When you're eating, waiting for your food.
Not eating. Don't eat it. Look at your phone,
but
when you're waiting
for your food
at a restaurant, you're probably...
Well, actually, don't look at it right then.
No,
wait till after you
look at this stuff.
But you would really
think, hey,
these guys,
this
really happened.
Look at this.
These were just
like you and me,
except back then. Look at them. Look at the people
in the back.
The detail.
Look at the guy over there.
He's making weird faces.
He's thinking something. And those are the people back then. That lived so long ago that we look at
so
differently than us now, but
there were
so much
the same
with us.
Well, that's my first video here on ancient Assyria, and I might have
more to
add to
this
subject,
but I
know I'm going
to be covering a lot of history because
that's
my
main
interest.
It's not just
an interest,
it's a huge hobby
for me.
It's
geography
and world history.
So, if you ever
needed
some help with your history homework,
I'm pretty
good at that.
Hopefully
these videos
can
help you.
Oh, I
cover just about
every
period
of time.
I'm exceptionally
into
anything
from
the BC
period,
especially
the more
obscure civilizations,
like
the Minoans or
the
everything
in Turkey.
I don't know
why,
but I like Pontus
and civilizations that are more
obscure,
the Sumerians
or
Cimmeria
is
what they call
it. You
know, when you see
a C
and you pronounce
that as,
but I think it's
pronounced
Cimmeria. I
love
those. I don't know
why
I love those guys
so much.
Proto-Slavic
civilizations,
you know,
all
of the civilizations
that
are involved
in
the area
that's
now Russia.
I don't
know where
I'm into
that.
You know, of course,
everybody
has
their
own
taste
in stuff,
but me,
and
I also
like ancient
Greece,
just like a lot of
historians,
and
I
have
a lot of
knowledge of
ancient
Greece
and ancient Rome
and
of
Carthage.
Something
that
I also
would love
to get
into full
detail
of.
Carthage,
well,
how
full detail
can you get?
You know,
we're going
past
the Dark
Ages
where
there's
very little
historical
record.
But
when
you've
looked
through all
the pieces
of the
puzzle,
as
I
have,
and
so
many different
things,
I've
gathered
so much information
that
so
much of
it gets
pushed
in
and out
of my
mind,
and
I have
to go and
retract,
find
that
information
that
got pushed
out.
It's like
your mind
can only
hold
so
much.
And
the Phoenicians.
So
I would
love
to
do
anything
about
that
because
the
Phoenicians
actually
were
capable
of making
that
Atlantic
voyage
to
America.
Their ships. Not only
their ships.
The people
who
actually
directed
those
ships.
They
could
have
actually
crossed
the
Atlantic.
They
could
have
brought
the
supplies
necessary.
You know,
of course,
that would
take them
down
that
slope
past
the Pillars
of Hercules,
down
into South
America. Think
about
that.
But of course,
they
worship
the
sun god. So,
yeah.
What does
that have
to do
with
the
civilizations
that
emerged
in South
America? Sarcasm.